of his grace. We do not read the word to get something. The word of God is not a means to get something. The word of God is the end. It's not a means to an end. Stop approaching the word of God as a means to an end. Approach the word of God as the end. As the end. The knowledge of the word is the end in itself. Jesus said in John chapter 17 verse number 3, John chapter 17 verse number 3, and this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, that is Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. This is life eternal, that they may know thee. We study the word of God not to get things. We study the word of God to know him, that they may know thee. That's why it is the end. It's not a means. It's not a tool. The word of God is not a tool we use for getting material things. The word of God is the end in itself. We are not learning to get something out of God. It is to come to the place of knowing him in the word. And when we know him, that is the end. If any man glory, let him glory in this, that he knows me. Let him glory that he knows me. That's the pursuit of the believer. Brother Paul, speaking after many years of ministry, in the book of Philippians chapter 3 verse 10, arrived at, after about 30 years of ministry, look at what he was still praying for. That I may know him. That I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death. That I may know him. That's the pursuit. Not to get something out of God. Someone will say, well, what's in it for me? What's in it for you is that you know God. That's what is in it for you. I mean, if you're looking for how to make money, you don't come here to make money. You go to business schools, you know, or you go to where they will teach you how to trade in cryptocurrency or how to trade in forex, or you go to where they will teach you how to make money, how to make soap, how to produce clothes, there are places where they will teach you all of that with professionality, and you will come out and make plenty of money. There are places where you do all of that. You come here to know him. That's what you come for. And it's unfortunate that the church has presented the church as a place where you pass through to get to where you're going, as a means to an end. And that is why people come to church with wrong appetites. They come to church with wrong appetites. So they are waiting for you to say, your problem will be solved. Amen. And if you don't say that, it's not a good service. See, because they don't know the mission of the church. The mission of the church is to teach you Christ. In knowing Christ, you find fulfillment. In knowing Christ, you find satisfaction. This is life eternal, that they may know you. If any man glory, let him glory in this, that he knows him. You know, and the Bible, you know, warns us of this kind of Christianity. And the Bible warns us of those who teach gain as godliness. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 6 verse 3. And Brother Paul, speaking to Timothy, a bishop, said to Timothy, if any man teach otherwise and consent not to wholesome words, hugaino, wholesome, healthy. What is hugaino? What are those words that are wholesome? Even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ. And to the doctrine, the didascalia, to the teaching, to the explanation, which is according to godliness. Look at the next verse. If anybody is teaching otherwise, he is proud, knowing nothing. Anybody that teaches you anything that is not to reveal Christ is proud. Even if he's wearing okrika, knicker and t-shirt, he is proud. Knowing nothing, but doting about questions and strife of words, whereof commit envy, strife, railings, evil surmisings. Next verse. Perverse disputings of men of corrupt minds. And he is destitute of the truth. He is broke. To be destitute means you are broke. He is broke. He doesn't have the truth. He's empty. He is devoid of the truth. Supposing, now, those are the people who preach that gain is godliness. You know what gain is godliness is? That's their message. You will make it. You will get there. You will get there. You cannot serve God and not buy a car. You cannot serve God and not build a house. You cannot serve God and be poor. Bible says such people are destitute. Because their message is that your godliness is measured by gain. What kind of car are you driving? That is what reveals God in your life. What kind of house do you have? How much money do you have in your bank account? That is the measure of God in your life. If you don't give a testimony, you may be living in sin. You know, those are the churches where you have people say, I came to this church. This is just 2 weeks. The evidence is outside. I just bought a second-hand Prado Jeep. It's outside. 2 weeks only. I just joined this church. I've not been long in this church. This is just 1 week now. The lady has agreed to marry me. I just came to this church for 1 month. I've been looking for fruit of the womb. God is here. God is here. My wife is pregnant. Those are the messages that rob you of your reality in Christ. Supposing that gain is godliness. From such messages, from such preachers, from such churches, withdraw thyself. Withdraw yourself. From such ministries, withdraw yourself. Look at the next verse. Oh my goodness, I love Brother Paul. But godliness with contentment is great gain. Next verse. For it is certain we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we carry nothing out. Next verse. And having food and raiment, let us be there with content. Let's be satisfied. Such messages put you under undue pressure. Such messages put you in a place of competition. Such place put you in a place of jealousy. They make you unhappy as a Christian. They bring you to a place where you're not contented as a child of God, because you are measuring your true value on material things. What did Jesus teach? Jesus said, if our hope is only in this world, material stuff, we are of all men most miserable. Now, so such churches where they teach you that gain is godliness, what they do is they make the word of God a means to an end. They make you use God to solve your problems. You use God to get your material stuff. You use God. And the true measure of your spirituality will be by the things you have. So people are compelled in such churches to give lying testimonies, to fabricate stories, to exaggerate, because the only way they can be important among brethren is by the volume of their testimony. But if any man glory, let him glory in this, that he knows me. Oh, I didn't hear a powerful amen. That's why when you teach the word and say God prospers everybody equally, believers and unbelievers, they get angry with us. When we say, look, there's no special privilege for you as a Christian in material wealth. The same God is rich to all. He has blessed the good and the bad. If it's material, he has given, made the rain to fall on the righteous and on the unrighteous. He has made the sun to shine on the thankful and on the unthankful. Material things are given to all of us, every human being, because God loves the whole world. God doesn't want anybody to die in hunger. So he gave this world to all of us to access the treasures in it. Are you hearing me? It's not an exclusive for Christians. But there is something that is exclusive to us, and those are the things in Christ. You cannot access the things in Christ except you are in Christ. That's what we have that the unbeliever doesn't have. That's our advantage. Brenda Kotalaha Hegebozaka. That is what we have that the world cannot get. That is what we have that the world cannot explain. The world knows us not because it knew him not. Why? We are in him. That's our exclusive reserve. He has given us something more than material stuff. What we have is eternal life. We have the gift of righteousness through faith. Hallelujah.